right. Well, thank you so much. We'll get PowerPoint set up here and everything going. Well, I bring you greetings from the great state of Arizona. Who's been to Arizona? Wow. Who's been there in August? On purpose. Both of you. And I know what everybody here, they always go, well, it's not that hot. It's what? It's a dry heat. Well, just get this straight. It might be a dry heat, but so's your oven, okay? So, but it is great to be here. Now, look at that title. I wanted to put it up there because I have the longest title. They had to get a special business card, you know, for the, I am the Gary D. Chapman Chair of Marriage and Family Ministry and Therapy at Moody Theological Seminary. So that's all my time. Let's close and pray. No, but what a great, it may be the longest title in the world, but I have the greatest job in the planet because I get to go all over the country, starting right here in Chicago and then heading on, being a voice for marriage and family. And so what in the world does, I thought, well, if I've got this time, what in the world does an endowed chair do? Now, think about your major in college, for example. There was a chair of a department. They actually have to work, okay? What does an endowed chair do? Well, they work too, but that means, again, you get to be a voice. It's a research position. So I get to interface with the president, with the seminary, with the undergraduate, with all kinds of different areas. And we've launched a brand new MA program that's a clinical program, a licensure program. In fact, not far from where we're at, I hope you'll go by and maybe see it while you're here, is we have a brand new clinic. First time we've got a community clinic right here on Moody, right here at Moody. And 4 months into it, guess what? We already have a waiting list, and half of the people are from the community, that where our students are getting to speak into the lives of people. And it's headed by Dr. Deborah Gordon, who's just an outstanding person. When we went to hire her to run this clinical program, I sat down with her, and you know, never met her, and I go, well, hey, where are you from? And she goes, well, I'm from Arizona. I go, really? I'm from Arizona. And she goes, oh, I know. You were my Awana leader. And I said, well, gosh, you look just like you did when you were 5 years old. I hadn't seen her since she was five, and now she's grown up and I'm old. But the point is she's phenomenal. That program's great. Not only that, but we're working on right now a brand new MA program at the seminary where we'll be training this next generation of family pastors and men's and women's ministers and just anybody that wants to walk well with families in their church. Dr. Nyquist hopefully has already fallen asleep, so he won't see this next slide. But we're also working on Moody's first D-Men program. Now, this is not an announcement, okay? This is not an announcement because I don't know if you know anything about academia. I didn't know that much about it, but you have to go through all these committees. So we still have another 30 committees probably to go through, which is why it's taken 130 years, I think, to get a D-Men. But actually, really and truly, we're right in the middle of building D-Men program that's going to take God's word and relationship skills and put them together and just be awesome. And guess what? Come back in 2 years, Lord willing, and right in front of the Sweeting Building, which is over here, you'll get to see the Chapman Center. Now, what is that? Well, it's like they hired me to be the head coach with Marriage and Family, and then they go, oh, we're going to build you a stadium. So picture one floor is education, another floor is radio, another floor is Moody Publishing, and you take all of those and combine them together. Really and truly, the fourth floor is a collaborative floor where we're going to be taking people and train them as biblical scholars, but then they need to be able to write well. But wait a minute, then they need to be able to communicate well to this generation, and that'll be all done. And so our goal is to really come alongside you to encourage you and your church and train people that'll be taking God's word all over the country, but it'll really be a great opportunity for us to say, hey, in this day and age, is the family under attack in this day and age, you think? So what an amazing timing and a chance to get to do that. So that's what I do, and the reason I kind of shared that is, like you, I'm fairly busy, okay? But I want you to understand something. With all the important things that take up our time, that are so important, there is something else incredibly important that is just amazingly easy to skip. And I don't know why it is, but bottom line is, I think for a lot of us, it's so easy to skip bringing the blessing home. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, I remember years ago, the first marriage and family class I had was with a guy named Dr. Howard Hendricks. Anybody remember Howie? And I remember Howie saying time and time again in class, he goes, you know what? If it doesn't work at home, don't export it. And it was the idea that, you know what? We need to bring God's word and God's love home to our family and then take it out to the world. But it's so easy to do all these important things. And then do we really bless those ones that God has placed in our home? And what does that really mean? Well, that's what I want to share with you today. How do you bring home the blessing to your loved one? But to do that, I want you to understand that everyone here, each person up in the balcony, all throughout here, every one of us either grew up in a home where we either received or were denied the blessing. Now, where do you see that in God's word? Well, Genesis chapter 27 is where I'm going to have us turn. So let me pray, and then we'll look at Genesis 27, and we'll jump into then some specifics on how do you bring the blessing home. So let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Lord, we are so grateful for the opportunity to worship together, now for a chance to look again at your word. And as we, in this case, look at a father who made a choice to bless one kid, but not the other. And Lord, the repercussions of that, now this was all in your economy, all in your will, and it wasn't necessarily a paradigm, thankfully. Lord, we can bless every kid in our home. Each person, we're called to be a blessing, not just with our family, but those that you've placed us in relationship with. So Lord, help us, regardless of where we are in that journey of walking well with the people you've placed us well with, help us to really understand, well, what does it mean to bless, that we might be that person that in so many ways, you know, doesn't just help everybody else's family, but pours the blessing into our own home as well. So we love you and thank you, Lord. In your name we do pray, and all God's people said, amen. Now, I'll just go through this quickly. Genesis chapter 27. I've always loved this passage in the Bible because I'm a twin, and my mom always liked Jeff best. It says, now it came about when Isaac was old and his eyes were too dim to see that he called his older son Esau. Remember this? And he said, my son, and he said, here I am. And Isaac said, well, behold, I'm old. I don't know the day of my death. So please bring your gear, your quiver, and your bow, and go out and hunt a game for me and prepare a savory dish such as I love and bring it to me that I might bless you before I die. Now, we know, studying the blessing, and I was a Greek major because I got some bad advice. I was a new Christian. I didn't know New Testament meant Greek. Isn't that terrible? And I also didn't know at the time that in seminary, if you majored in Greek, you automatically had to minor in Hebrew. So that was a great 4 years of my life, never even having had Spanish, you know. But when you're a Greek or a Hebrew major, what do? You end up doing lots of word studies. So the word bless, what does the word bless mean? Well, let me show you real quick. Lean over to somebody right next to you and bow to them. All right, so turn over. This won't kill you. Just lean over to somebody and bow to them. Okay, now, how weird is that? That is pretty weird. For Americans, we don't get that. We're not really into bowing. Think about the Olympics. What does every nation on earth do on the Olympics if in the parade of nations, if there's royalty, like when Queen Elizabeth was up there, every nation on earth, their flag bearer in the parade of nations, when they come up to the queen or king, if there's royalty in the host country, what do they do with their flag? Dip their flag, except for who? Americans, we have never dipped our flag in Olympic history. This isn't on radio, right? This isn't being... Anyway. So humility is really good for you. I don't know if you knew that. That's really good. So, but anyway, long story short is that nobody... So we don't get the idea. Americans, we don't get this idea very well of but hang on a minute. The blessing, remember how all of so many Hebrew words have word pictures? There's really two pictures behind the word blessing. One is to bow the knee because someone's so valuable. But hang on a second. The second one is to add a coin to a scale. So reach in your wallet and hand some money to... No, don't do that. Okay. But do you get the idea? So now we know, Lord, bless the Lord, O my soul. Lord, you are so valuable. I bow the knee and I want to add my little bit of praise to you. Well, you know what, men and women? We get the privilege and honor... We're called not just to be a blessing to those in our congregation, but to bless those in our home. Well, here in Genesis chapter 27, I'll just fast forward. You know the story. Out goes Esau to hunt. At the same time, Jacob's mom grabs him, and she's a better hunter, and cooks up a good-smelling meal because she doesn't want her son to lose this blessing. Because earlier in the book of Genesis, it said the younger, not the older, was to receive that blessing. And long story shorter is they trick the dad into blessing him, and after the father finally is convinced that it must be Esau, it's really Jacob, but he says, well, now please come close and kiss me, my son. And when he had come close and kissed him, and he had smelled the smell of his garments, he blessed him and said, see, the smell of my son is like the smell of a field that the Lord had blessed. Now may God give you the dew of heaven and the fatness of earth and an abundance of grain and new wine. And he gives him a great blessing, and out walks Jacob. And biblically, once you gave a blessing to someone, it was irretrievable, irrevocable. It now rested on Jacob, and he got it. Now again, you could give a blessing to every child. You see that in Genesis 47, Genesis 48. All of the kids, Jacob's kids, get a blessing. And yet here, only one will. And now we read, now it came about as soon as Isaac had finished blessing Jacob, and Jacob had hardly come out from the presence of his father, that Esau came in from his hunting. Now, he's thinking he's going to get the blessing. Instead, his father, he had made savory food for his father, and he said, let my father arise and eat of your son's game and bless me. And Isaac said, well, who are you? And he goes, well, I'm your firstborn Esau. And when Isaac trembled violently then, he said, who was it then that hunted game and brought it to me so that I ate of all of it before you came and blessed him? And yes, he shall be blessed. Now stay with me. Guess what? What does he say? Then he says what? He cries out with an exceedingly great and bitter cry and says, bless me, even me also, O my father. He repeats himself later and says, do you have only one blessing, my father? Bless me, even me also, O my father. Well, I'm here to tell you, I really believe every kid in every home deserves to have at least one person in their life that's crazy about them, that communicates to them that, you know what, you have my blessing. Now, let me show you a picture of this. I have a friend. His name is Rudy Paris. He was a broken-down bar singer. That's how he describes himself, and had a major heart attack, and the doctor said, you're going to die, so if you want to make peace with, God or whatever, we're going to lose you. And while he was in the emergency room, he prayed. His mother had shared Christ with him all his life. And while he was in the emergency room, he prayed and asked Christ to come into his life and pulled through. And so he ended up as a worship pastor in Washington State. And his senior pastor said to him, you know what, Rudy, you need to go on The Voice. And he goes, well, I did all that secular stuff. I'm not doing that. He goes, no, this time you need to go on The Voice for the Lord, not for you. And but what do you have to do at The Voice? Well, let me show you. This is for those that don't know. Let's
every breath
here we go.
You take, every move
I told you.
You.
I knew it.
So they can't see you, right?
Bond you break,
they can just hear your voice. And you're laying it out there in front of millions of people and those judges. Look how bored he looks. But one of those judges, at least one, has to do what? If you've never seen The Voice, what do they have to do? They got to hit that voice. If they do, they don't always. Watch what happens if one of them hits that. Boom. Let's crank up the volume a little bit on that, you know. And you see at the bottom? What did it say at the bottom? Okay, keep it going just for a minute. Boom, and they hit that button, you know. And now, to me, that's a great picture of, of what that means for so many of us and with our kids, man. We would love it if somebody in our life just hit that button and turned toward us and said, I want you. So I want us to dig into this, to look a little bit closer of what that blessing is, and to do that, here's what I need you to do. And I don't think this will strain anybody out, and if it does, feel free to be really uncomfortable, all right? But up at the top, in the balcony, everybody in the back, up here in the front, at the count of three, here's what I need for you to do. At the count of three, I need you to stand up when I tell you, and you're going to have to walk around a little bit, so just leave your stuff. Nobody will take it. You'll find, and I want you to find two people, stay with me, that you don't know. They're not your best friend. You didn't drive here with them from Pennsylvania. I want you to get in a group of three, not four, not five, not with your spouse if your spouse is here. So I want you to get in a group of three, not four, not five, group of three. I've counted. It'll work perfectly. And then when you're in a group of three, look up, and I'll tell you what we're going to do. Ready, go. Stand up, get in a group of three. Stand up and get in a group of three. Walk around, find somebody in your group. Raise your hand if there's a group of two or a group of three. Okay. All right, everybody's maybe up there. They're walking around. If there's a group of four, there's a couple of guys right there. One can go over there. Okay. All right. Now. Okay. So here's what I need for you to do. Let's give it up for our volunteer group right here in the front. Here's our volunteer group. Let's give it up for them. Way to go. All right. So what I need y'all to do, and then everybody else here is going to do likewise, okay, is somebody in your group pick one, somebody pick two, somebody pick three in your group. Ready? Go. Somebody pick. If there's four, go ahead and pick four. If there's four, if you can't count. Somebody pick one, somebody pick two, somebody pick three. All right. So now here's what I need for you to do, all right? When I tell you in just a second, I don't know if you know this, but if you've ever been to anything I've ever done anywhere across the country, you know you never pick number three. You never pick number three. And there's a reason for this. I mean, the number ones, they love this kind of thing. And the number threes would have totally skipped this session if they knew they're going to have to talk to some total stranger, okay? So who's number three in your group? Tell me your name. Jeremy, okay, so Jeremy, here's what you're going to do. You're going to take 1 minute to tell the other two people in your group everything you can about yourself. Where you're from, how you came to know the Lord, where you're ministering now, what color is your hair really when you had hair. And so now number one and number two, this is real important, okay? While number three is talking, you have to act interested. You have to act interested, all right? Now, it says in the book of Proverbs, it says, bright eyes makes the heart glad. So for a whole minute, you can't say a word, number one and number two. You're just going to go, Tell me more. That is awesome, all right? And if you don't think 1 minute is a long time, I wrestled in college. It's forever, 1 minute. So here we go. Number three, all about yourself. Ready? Go right now. Here we go. All right, let's give it up for number three. All right, let's give it up for number three. All right. Okay, good job. So now it is time for number two, all about yourself. 1 minute, ready, go. Number two, all about yourself. Turn it up. All right, let's give it up for number two. All right, good job, number two. And now, finally, the people have been waiting to talk, the number ones. Should we give them 2 minutes? The number of 5 minutes. Yes, 5 minutes. No, no, no. 1 minute, like everybody else. Why don't you begin right now? Go, number one, number one. All right, let's give it up for number one. All right, good job, number one. All right, good job. All right, so now I know it's hard for the number ones to stop talking, but so now here's something else you're going to do for the rest of the time. There isn't that much time left, so hang with me. But you're just going to stand up. You're going to be sitting the rest of the week. So you're just going to stand up, and these are your new best friends, all right, that you just heard about. Okay, so let me go through a couple of these because I'll share something about it, and then you'll you're going to talk about it, and this is called connecting. Okay, so here we go. Here's number one. Every time a blessing was given, and I want you to think back when you were 10 years old, okay? When you were 10 years old. In your group, real quick, share with them, where were you when you were 10 years old? All of you, all three of you, quick, real quick. Where were you when you were 10 years old? Where were you when you were 10 years old? Okay. Okay. All right, did you get around? Where were you when you were 10 years old? So stay with me because you'll be jumping back into that in just a second. But every time there was a blessing given in Scripture, there was appropriate, meaningful touch. And Jesus put them in his arms and blessed them. Genesis chapter 27, get over here and hug me, my son. Now Esau was how old when he got blessed by his dad? Isaac, 40 years old. And when Jacob got blessed by his dad. How do you know that? Because it says in Genesis chapter 26 that Esau was 40. If Esau is 40, how old's Jacob? 40. I'm a twin. I got that just like that. Okay. So here's a dad that's hugging a 40-year-old and gives him his blessing. Okay. There was the laying on of hands. So here's what I want you to, in your you're 10 years old. Did you grow up in a home where there was appropriate, meaningful touch? 10 years old. Were there people that were crazy about you that said, get over here and give me a hug? All three of you talk. 3, 2, 1, real quick. Yes or no? Were you, did you grow up in a home where... Jump into that group right there. Just jump into that group right there. Yeah, jump him. Yeah, let him join you. Okay, did you get around? Okay, here's the second thing. Every time a blessing was given, it was always verbalized. It was always verbalized. Now, I grew up in a single-parent home. My mom and dad divorced when I was 2.5 months old. I never met my dad till I was in high school. When I did meet him, he was an angry alcoholic, and I used to hate my dad. And then I became a Christian, and I just intensely disliked him. And then I finally realized, well, you know what? If I don't forgive him, I'm going to become just like him. And that's really what I was doing. And so I took my dad out to a Red Lobster, really nice restaurant, and at the end of the meal, I said, Dad, I've been so angry at you for so long, and I just want to ask your forgiveness. And I didn't go with any expectation that he would change, but I remember he goes, well, if you need that, that's fine. And I go, well, I do need it. But I remember when my dad was dying, I had tried to build a relationship with him over the years and, held his hand. And never, on the last day of my dad's life, he died of congestive heart and lung failure. I won't go into details, but he basically choked to death. It's a horrendous way to die. And as I prayed for him, he cussed at me for praying for him. He was so broken from the war, World War II. He was a 3rd Marine Division guy that was still fighting the war and an alcoholic and so broken. And I never heard verbally words of blessing from him. But I thank God that I had an uncle, a great uncle, Uncle Max. And I met him when I was in college at TCU. And he had the great honor and privilege of leading Uncle Max to Christ. He was a librarian, the head librarian at SMU, and just built a great relationship with him. And he would just pour encouragement and affirmation into my life. And I want you to show you something I carry. everywhere, which is why it's in such bad shape. I need to make a Xerox of this or something. But I never got the blessing from my dad, but here's a letter that I carry from Uncle Max. He goes, "Now, it may come as a surprise for you to learn, but I have just decided to do a living will. He is dying of cancer now, and I'm the one that has to say no heroics." Do you know what I'm talking about? Anybody been there? And he goes, "And I know you'll agree with its principles," and he says some nice things about me and that the lawyer is going to contact me. But he goes, "Thank you, John. You've helped me so much in the past, and I'm sure you will continue to do so. And look at this, because you are my son." Now, my own dad just never chose to put his name on me. I carry his name, but he never chose to put it on me. But I thank God that he put somebody in my life, Uncle Max, that chose to do that. So in your group, real quick, who's somebody in your life story that chose to bless you? Number three, number two, number one, real quick. Ready? Go ahead, right there, okay? You about ready? Okay, just a minute. Okay, you can go back to there. Okay. All right. We could go on forever, but so every time a blessing was given in Scripture, there was appropriate touch. Somebody would use their words to attach high value to you, which really helps somebody really believe that they had a special future. And then with that came one more thing, which was genuine commitment. The fact that, you know what, even if there are times where we're not easily blessable, that person makes a decision that we're worth hanging in there with. And I thank God that he's put some people like that in my life. Now, I could talk to you about attaching high value and choosing life over death, blessing over curse. And I could talk to you about the blessing and genuine commitment. But show and tell is always better than show, right? So I want to introduce you to some friends of mine that came all the way from California. This is Tom Stewart and Georgia Stewart and Sean Stewart. And Tom, tell them a little bit about the choice you guys made, and then Sean's gonna make a choice to sing to us in just a minute. But tell us your story real quick.
Okay, after years of marriage, we decided to have a little boy. And he was little. He was 2 pounds, 12 ounces at birth. He had major problems, and we were in the neonatal intensive care unit. The doctor said, "Well, you know, we could set him off to the side, no tubes, no feeding apparatus, no respirator for the lungs. We could set him off in the corner, and then you could try again." Well, at the time, we weren't Christians. And Sean was a blessing to us because after a couple years and a lot of seeds that were planted by people, we came to know Jesus Christ. Yeah. And it was through this guy right here that we came to know Jesus Christ.
And then the Lord changed our attitudes. Before I was a Christian, I was bitter and jealous. bitter that I didn't have a normal child, jealous of parents that did. Then we got saved when Sean was 2, started reading the Bible every day, and I learned, of course, about God's sovereignty and that he's in control of all things and he brings good out of all things. And then I was blessed by when Jesus spoke to his disciples and said, this man born blind, it's not a result of his sins or his parents' sins, but so God could be glorified in his life. And the Lord spoke to my heart and said, whether Sean's healed in this lifetime physically or not, I will be glorified through his life.
Amen. Wow. Well, so talk about choosing life over death, blessing over curse. And Sean, we've had the privilege of getting to hear you sing, and I wanted these men and women to hear that too. And so there's a song that really captures your life story and this whole idea of blessing, why we need to choose to bless people. And would you sing it for us?
This is called The Blessing. And one thing I really want to affirm you on is that I want to say from personal experience that the principles you are giving right now, as far as giving the blessing and everything, they work. I've watched my mom and dad for a long time, and I really admire both of you guys for choosing to let me live and give the blessing to the family. So.
Amen.
So this is called The Blessing. So you can roll it.
I arrived at 2 pounds 12, heard the preemie doctor say, did my parents want heroics, or let nature have its way? My folks said I was a fighter, and they were fighters too, so they teamed up with the medics, and the good Lord saw us through. 9 months later, they all knew I wouldn't be like other kids. Shattered dreams, desperation brought my parents to their knees. And through it all, I remember Mom and Dad would say to me, you're the apple of my eye, and you will soar on eagle's wings. Wrestling Dad was awesome. He'd say I was growing strong, and I remember drawing comfort from Mom's sweet tender song. They would say, God has great things in store for me. I had to claim his victory. I'm part of God's great victory. Growing up had heartaches, but we shared great moments too. Looking past my limitations, I could share what God can do. And through it all, I remember Mom and Dad would say to me, you're the apple of my eye, and you will soar on eagle's wings. Life still has its trials, times along, times of doubt, feeling useless almost robbed me of my song. But through it all, I remember Mom and Dad would say to me, you're the apple my eye, and you will so, you will so.
Well, in just a minute, Aaron's going to come up, and we'll close off with a song. But just before we do, you still in your group of three? Okay, here's what I'd like you to do as we close up, is find out who in your group of three or four, if there's four, if you can't count, that's no problem. Find out who has known the Lord the longest in your group right now. Well, they're coming up, and before it, who's? All right. Okay. So here's what I'd like you to do. Here's what I'd like you to do, a little appropriate, meaningful touch. Just put your hand on each other's shoulders, okay? And then whoever that person is that's known the longest, would you pray a blessing over those people? You heard their stories, and just pray a blessing over them and their families, and that we would be a blessing. And when you're done praying just for your group, then look up so we know you're done, and then I'll close this in just a minute. But the one that's known the Lord the longest, you're going to just pray for those in your group. Ready? Go. Here we go. Well, let me pray as we finish up. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for the opportunities we get at this conference to learn how to go back and how to bless so many in so many ways. But Lord, it really does start at home. And thank you for the choice you made to send your son. Thank you for the words of blessing you spoke over him. This is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Lord, help us to go back home and to be men and women that bless those that you've placed in our life story. And we know we can do that because of the words of this song we're about to hear. In your precious name, we do pray, Lord Jesus. Amen.